The Thing in the Cellar by David H. Keller, narrated by Mark Bowen. It was a huge cellar, entirely out of proportion to the size of the house above it. The owner admitted that it was probably built for a distinctly different kind of structure from that which rose above it. Probably, the first house had been burned, and poverty had caused a diminution of the dwelling erected to take its place. A winding stone stairway connected the cellar with the kitchen. Round the base of this series of steps, successive owners of the house had placed their firewood, winter vegetables, and junk. The junk had gradually been pushed back till it rose, head high, in a barricade of uselessness. What was behind that barricade, no one knew, and no one cared. For some hundreds of years, no one had crossed it to penetrate to the black reaches of the cellar behind it. At the top of the steps, separating the kitchen from the cellar, was a stout oaken door. This door was, in a way, as peculiar and out of relation to the rest of the house as the cellar. It was a strange kind of door to find in a modern house, and certainly a most unusual door to find in the inside of the house. Thick, stoutly built, dexterously rebutted together, with huge wrought iron hinges and a lock that looked as though it came from Castle Despair. Separating a house from the outside world, such a door would be excusable. Swinging between kitchen and cellar, it seemed peculiarly inappropriate. From the earliest months of his life, Tommy Tucker seemed unhappy in the kitchen. In the front parlor, in the formal dining room, and especially on the first floor of the house, he acted like a normal, healthy child. But carry him to the kitchen, and he began at once to cry. His parents, being plain people, ate in the kitchen, save when they had company. Being poor, Mrs. Tucker did most of her work, though occasionally she had a charwoman in to do the extra Saturday cleaning, and thus much of her time was spent in the kitchen. And Tommy stayed with her, at least as long as he was unable to walk. Much of the time, he was decidedly unhappy. When Tommy learned to crawl, he lost no time in leaving the kitchen. No sooner was his mother's back turned than the little fellow crawled as fast as he could for the doorway, opening into the front of the house, the dining room, and the parlor. Once away from the kitchen, he seemed happy. At least he ceased to cry. On being returned to the kitchen, his howls so thoroughly convinced the neighbors that he had colic that more than one bowl of catnip and sage tea was brought to his assistance. It was not until the boy learned to talk that the Tuckers had any idea as to what made him cry so hard when he was in the kitchen. In other words, the baby had to suffer for many months before he obtained at least a little relief, and even when he told his parents what was the matter, they were absolutely unable to comprehend. This is not to be wondered at, because they were both hard-working, rather simple-minded persons. What they finally learned from their little son was this: that if the cellar door was shut and securely fastened with a heavy iron lock, Tommy could at least eat a meal in peace. If the door was simply closed but not locked, he shivered with fear but kept quiet. But if the door was open, if even the slightest streak of black showed that it was not tightly shut, then the little three-year-old would scream himself to the point of exhaustion, especially if his tired father refused him permission to leave the kitchen. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.